Welcome to Community Connection. I'm your host, Gloria Enloe. Now, for those of you who may not have seen the show before, the goal of Community Connection is pretty simple. We live and work in Jefferson City, and we think it's a great place to live and work and play. There is a lot of things to do in Jefferson City. You just need to know where to find them. So we're going to help you out with that a little bit today. My guest today is John Dougan from the Missouri State Archives. John, welcome to the show.
Thank you for the invitation.
Well, John, like I said, there is a lot to do in Missouri, and one place that people can do a little bit of entertaining and fun things is the archives. Can you tell us a little bit about the archives? I mean, obviously you might think it's just a big room of documents, but what exactly can be found there?
Well, at the Missouri State Archives, we do have a lot of different records from state government, local government. We probably have a little over 300 million pages of records that people can do all kinds of research in. One example of the kind of records we have is we have over 500,000 photographs from all over the state. And we have researchers from all over the world that come and do research at our facility. But it's a great place to start doing Jefferson City research, too.
And now, can anyone just walk in and start looking around and doing a little bit of research?
Sure. We're open to the public. Our hours are 8 to 5, Monday through Friday. We have evening hours on Thursday evenings, and then we're open 9 to 3 on Saturday. So even on the weekends, you can come in and do research.
Now, some people might not have had a lot of experience with doing research and paging through documents and knowing where to find something, much more advanced beyond a Google search. Are there people there at the archives that can maybe help people and get them pointed in the right direction?
Absolutely. Our reference staff are there. They get people started at all levels of research experience, whether you're a beginning genealogist or a tenured faculty member who's doing academic research. They're there to help you and to get you started, to show you the finding aid, show you how to find the records for yourself, how to use the equipment, all those kinds of things, absolutely.
Well, you mentioned genealogy. Now, it's something that's growing in popularity. I know a lot of people personally that are starting to trace their family tree and their ancestry and finding out what kind of connections they have here in Missouri to historical events. What would you recommend for someone who's maybe interested in getting started in that?
If you've not done genealogy before, what we always recommend that you do is you start from what you know and kind of work backwards. So you start from your parents, your grandparents, maybe your great-grandparents, if you're fortunate enough to know them, and focus on kind of vital dates and places. So you want to know where they were born, when they were born, where they were married and when they were married, and where if you can get the information on previous generations, where they died, where they're buried, when they died. If you can get those basic dates, then you can start with some of the core research resources that we have at the archives, and those are really the Missouri death certificates. They have a lot of information about the previous generation, so you can kind of use them and go back all the way to 1910 with the death certificates themselves, and the U.S. Census records, which are available from 1940 all the way back to the 1800s. So that's where we get people started, and then you can add other records, and we can help you kind of work from there. But that's where we recommend people start, is with those details on the family members they know, and then they can start working back from there.
Well, it sounds like there's a lot at the archives that they could help them with, and maybe even if you're not interested in genealogy, just Missouri history in general, sounds like there's a lot of information there.
Well, we have a tremendous number of records. They cover everything from the territorial period to the last legislative session. Wow. We see a lot of researchers that aren't genealogists, people that are doing academic research, legal research, people that are looking at the history of their home. There's just a vast assortment of students that are doing school projects. Of customers that we have at the archives. So.
Are there any specific collections you have that are really popular and generate a lot of interest?
The genealogy record series obviously probably are the most used. The death certificates, marriage records, naturalization records, juries of inquests where people have died, those have a lot of interest in them. We also have the Supreme Court case files, the Union Provost Marshal records from the Civil War. land records. You know, every day we have people coming in using just a huge assortment of resources, either in our reference room or on our website. MissouriDigitalHeritage.com is a website that we've created so that people can not only come in and do research, but can also do that from their homes as well.
Now, Jefferson City has quite a bit of history to it. Sure. You know, the Lewis and Clark expedition came through here. We have the old Missouri State Penitentiary that was in use up to a few years ago. Do you have records that specifically could teach people a little bit more about those sites and those events that took place in history?
We have a pretty large collection of Missouri State Penitentiary records. Those records really focus on the operation of the penitentiary itself, and many Jefferson City residents probably have had family members to work there. So we have some records related to that. But then they're especially rich on the inmates themselves. If they've ever had a relative or someone that they know that they want to research on that served time in the Missouri State Penitentiary, which was the largest penitentiary in the United States at one point in much of its history. You can come and do research on that. We've actually gotten a lot of use recently, though, with the inmate mug shots that we recently gotten the inmate photographs from the 1940s all the way up to when the penitentiary closed. Wow. And so we get several requests of that. Also, though, the big spike in research now has been because of the Civil War sesquicentennial. A lot of people are doing research on either family members that fought in the Civil War on the Confederate Union side, or they're doing research on incidences in their local history where there was a small skirmish or something like that. In Missouri, we were really known for a guerrilla warfare, and those Union Provost Marshal records that I talked about earlier that we put on our website, those are being used extensively by folks that are doing research on small battles that happen all over Missouri, and those are being used a lot too. So,
you talk a little bit about guerrilla warfare in Missouri. Is it just geographically the location kind of in between the north and the south, or is there certain reasons there were a lot of battles fought here?
We had the third most battles of any state in the Civil War, and the reason why that we had the third most battles is we don't have these extremely large battles like in the Eastern Theater. We have the smaller battles because these are oftentimes, like you're saying, because of the geography, much of Missouri is divided. We're a border state, so we had people with strong Confederate sympathies, strong Union sympathies, and a lot of these are skirmishes literally between a handful of neighbors and another handful of neighbors, or it might be just a small band of guerrillas attacking, you know, a private citizen. And so because of that, you see a lot more instances of actual battles than where you have these large armies that are juxtaposed against one another, mm-hmm. Waiting for a major battle to happen. So we have more small battles here, but most of the families know, if they've done family history research, they've heard a story or they've run across some citation of some event that's happened in their community, and these records that we have help kind of flesh out that story and tell that story.
Wow. One of the things I noticed when I was doing a little bit of research online is that you have some special projects too. Archives Alive was one of them, also the African American History Initiative. Can you tell us a little bit about those specialized projects?
Sure. Archives Alive is for fourth and fifth grade students. They are normally studying Missouri history in their classes, and it's a theatrical program where we have actors that portray kind of a broad spectrum of topics in Missouri history to reinforce what that they're getting in their Missouri history classes. They also tour the archives as part of that oftentimes as well. And it's just a good way to reinforce what our school teachers are doing in the classrooms and to kind of, you know, show them in 3D Missouri history. And it's really fun project. The African American History Initiative is pretty broad. We've done a lot of things over the years for developing curricula and developing access to historical records. Probably the thing we're most proud of with the African American History Initiative is our Freedom Petition project, where we've indexed and scanned about 300 freedom petitions from the St. Louis area and put those on the website. And those include the cases of Dred and Harriet Scott, but there were actually hundreds of those cases like the Dred Scott case. It's just that Dred Scott was the one that went to the U.S. Supreme Court, and that decision was made from that. So But there's a lot of different things we do with the African American History Initiative. So.
Wow. Yeah. You said that there has been a spike in research recently, but would you say you get a lot of visitors to the archives? And generally, what kind of age groups are you attracting there?
I don't know that I could put an age group on it. A lot of the genealogists are retired, but all of our other researchers are really run the gamut from school age all the way through to people that are using the archives for doing their research. But yes, we've seen a significant spike in both walk-in customers, where that we probably have 200 or 300% of what we had just last year, or at least in the last couple of years, of folks that are coming and doing research. And I think that's mainly because people have kind of learned that it's not all online. Mm-hmm. They do their research online, but they know there's a lot more records that aren't online, so they come and do the research in person. But I also have to say that Missouri Digital Heritage is growing exponentially. I mean, we're up to averaging like 6 to 7 million hits a month on that webpage.
Oh, wow.
So there's a lot of people out there doing research online,
right?
But there's a lot more that are sending us, there's a lot that are also sending us emails, that are coming in person and doing research, that are sending us plain old postal mail.
Right.
There's just a tremendous amount of research that's being done.
Well, I bet there's a lot of stuff, especially if it's older, that you just can't digitize everything, and sometimes you just gotta be there and pour through the pages.
And we prioritize what we scan. We try and put those things that are most requested online first.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of work through those. But there's so much more that's still in the archives. We have a few million pages online. We have 300 million pages in the archives. It'll take a long, long time. And we're adding every day to that collection. Just in the last couple of years, we've added 100,000 photographs to the collection. So I don't know that we'll ever get caught up.
Right, either.
So.
Constantly working on that.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, John, if there's anything else that you'd really like our viewers to know, what would that be?
Probably with this being a program for the Jefferson City area, one of the things I'd like to emphasize is every month we have a Thursday evening program that we'd love for folks to come and attend. This year it's been focused on the Civil War. And we have had Civil War speakers come in. Our next program is in November. It's on the 10th at 7 p.m. at the Kirkpatrick Information Center. And the topic that evening is going to be Lincoln and civil and citizens' rights. So we have nationally known authors and speakers that come in. And we hope that the community will come in and attend those programs as well.
All right. Well, John, thank you so much for coming in and talking to us about the Missouri State Archives today. I think that not a lot of people realize how much information is available right in their backyard, but it's a very interesting talk. Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
We'd like to thank our viewers at home for watching, too. Don't go anywhere, because we're going to come back in the second half and talk about more fun, entertaining events that are coming to Jefferson City. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Starts long before school does. Give your child the start they need at bornlearning.org.
More than half of America's most important military decisions are made here. No, it's not the Pentagon. Or NORAD. Or the headquarters of Air Combat Command. It's the place that employs over 50% of our armed forces. It's where you work.
See you in a couple weeks.
So when your employees in the National Guard and Reserve need time off to serve, give them the freedom to protect ours.
Hello, welcome back to Community Connection. I'm your host, Gloria Enloe. Now, during the first part of the show, we were talking with a guest from the Missouri State Archives about some of the things that the Archives offers for folks in Jefferson City if they're wanting to learn and do a little bit of research. And this show really is about telling people in Jefferson City what kind of resources are available to them and to the community for entertainment, but also for education, and sometimes the two can really go hand in hand. And with us during the second half of the show, we have Carmalee Hall from the Early Learning Center and Theresa Verslues from the United Way of Central Missouri. Welcome to the show.
Thanks.
Well, you guys each work for different departments or agencies, I guess you should say, but you're actually coming together today to talk about another group that you're representing. And what is that group?
It's the Capital Community Cares for Kids. It's a United Way initiative where it's an early childhood initiative where we're pulling together early childhood professionals and we're looking at different issues in the community. But the thing today that we want to talk about is a speaker that's coming here to Jefferson City, the parenting journey.
Okay, and I understand that this is coming up. It's going to be on November 10th. And can you tell us where this is taking place?
This is it's going to take place at the Old Southwest Elementary School in the gymnasium, and Dr. Goddard is from the University of Arkansas, and he has written several books and pamphlets, and it's just a great opportunity for parents or anyone in the community, and it's not just for early childhood, it goes through adolescence. He's going to touch on a little of everything, and that's going to be at 6 p.m. on Thursday.
Now, what are some of the things that he's going to be addressing when he comes to Jefferson City to give this talk?
A lot of it, his whole philosophy is like it says, it's a week of parenting journey. So he's going to come up with resources to help parents with the challenges of parenting. Also, he's going to be working with early childhood professionals and educators of how they can also work with their parents in the school system or the preschool setting of how to work with them through the challenge that we all have through parenting.
Now, Carmalee, can you tell us a little bit about what you do outside of this coalition? Because I understand that the coalition kind of is bringing people together from all facets of child care and child education, right?
Correct. I am actually with CMCA. I'm at Capital Early Learning Center, which is the Early Head Start program. It's right over here on Marshall Street, next door to you. And we work also with Lincoln University very closely with my particular site. On the other side of you is Cole County's Cole East Head Start. And so you're surrounded by Head Start. We work on, instead of just education for the child, we're not a daycare really, we do the whole child. We do health, mental health, nutrition.
Right, and then you also have the Early Head Start at some of the facilities here that you work with.
That's actually the one I am at, and we have another one at Southwest, and we have partnerships, and I don't want to go into naming them because I would leave someone out,
right.
But we have some partnerships with both home daycares and Jeff City Daycare. So we're really reaching out and trying to be a whole community that cares for children.
So this presentation is going to be given by Dr. Goddard. I mean, obviously, there are some people that already know about it and are interested in about it, but you're really trying to open this up to the whole community, right?
That's correct.
Anyone can go?
Right. Mm-hmm. There's actually a whole week. The week of November 7th is a whole week dedicated to the parenting journey. Some of the events will be in Columbia, but the one here in the capital city is the one that you mentioned on November 10th. And we really encourage parents, educators, anyone that has young children, or like you said, even all the way through adolescence, to come out and hear him speak. He's an award-winning speaker. He has received many awards. He has written many books regarding to parenting. And so I think his resources would be very valuable.
Now, some parents might hear this and say, well, you know, I'm not having any problems with my kids. My kids are happy and healthy, and we're not having any behavioral problems or anything like that. But I mean, it sounds like this isn't focused for just for parents that are struggling. It's for something that anyone can benefit from.
I think absolutely, yeah. Yes. Some of his books are soft-spoken parenting, so even though you're not having any problems with your child, there may be things come along later that you're not quite sure how to address. He has another book called Between Parent and Child, and we're focusing on the parenting journey, where he just goes through and talks about the whole aspects of being a parent. And I have had the privilege of seeing him on Skype and visiting with him. So it's really, I think anybody could benefit from it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it sounds like he's pretty accomplished speaker and author too. So it might not, kind of a rare opportunity to get to hear someone with those kind of credentials
yeah.
speak, I think.
Yeah.
Now, I understand that, he's coming to the area the week of that week in November, November 7th, but also the Capital Community Cares for Kids, they're actually doing things all throughout the year.
Right.
We have speakers come and kind of do weeks like that.
That's correct. The coalition kind of came out of the United Way. We have an early childhood initiative, and so we've kind of brought together a lot of early childhood professionals, not just with CMCA, with Head Start, but also Lincoln University and JC Daycare, and many other professionals in early childhood. And then basically as a group, we like to look at what are the needs here in the capital city for early childhood, and then what can we do as a group. Every spring we celebrate Week of the Young Child, so we've really tried to, as a group, come together. And we've worked with also parents as teachers, Jeff City Public Schools, and a lot of them from this group of bringing those activities. And here again, opening them up to the community, and not just daycare centers, but anyone that has children. So all year round, the group is constantly looking at, what other needs are out there and what can we do collectively as a group.
Well, Carmalee, you mentioned that at this event that Dr. Goddard is going to be speaking at, you're also going to have some resources available for parents, and that some of the parents are going to be getting books.
I know at least 50, the first 50 people who show up at the door, the first 50 families that show up, will get one of his books, and they run about $12 a piece, so that's another incentive to come. But I think if you didn't get anything but his influence on how to raise your children, everybody's going to take something away.
Well, and I think it's a good idea, too, because a lot of times when we have parent meetings, sometimes they focus on kids that are in a certain age range, but I think even new parents that have maybe just newborn babies and stuff, that this is stuff that they can learn and then apply later in life, too.
Oh,
so I think it's really helpful for parents at all stages and ages of life right now.
I definitely agree. I wish some of this would have been available when I was a younger parent.
Mm-hmm.
So I think anybody who doesn't take advantage of being able to go to this is really missing out on a great opportunity.
Okay. Well, I know that it's still a little bit early and that there's still stuff coming up next year, but I understand that there's going to be speakers coming then again later on into 2012 as well, right?
That's correct. excuse me. Dr. Walsh is going to be working with Columbia Cares for Kids, and that's going to be the week of February 6th through the 10th, and then April the 2nd through the 6th is Dr. Rebecca Beckner, and she works closely with Head Start and other parents as teachers, I think, and several other organizations, and she will be coming to Jeff City one evening if there's an interest in that. Hers is implementing positive behavior support systems in early childhood and elementary settings. So all of these are going to be great opportunities. They'll be furnished for people without a cost to them.
Great. And can you remind us one more time when the event that Dr. Goddard is coming to in Jefferson City is?
It'll be Thursday, November 10th. We'll start, doors will open up at 6. It's at Southwest School, the Early Childhood Center, here in over on St. Mary's Boulevard, here in Jefferson City. And we're just really excited. It's, like I said, it's open to the public. For parents or educators, we just think it will be very, very good, helpful information.
Well, it's kind of nice having that facility available now, too, for other things, because I'm sure many of our viewers remember that Southwest Elementary
right.
School. They probably remember going there, and now that a lot of those kids are going over to the new Pioneer Trail Elementary School. So.
Right, because right now it's the preschool.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
It's a nice setting for helping educate parents now instead of just kids.
Yeah.
Well, Theresa, Carmalee, thank you very much for joining us today. I really do appreciate it.
Well, thank you for having us. Yeah. I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thanks.
And I'd like to thank our viewers at home for watching. This is Community Connection, where we tell you about entertaining things that are coming to Jefferson City, fun things you can take advantage of. And these are fun things that are also going to help you learn a little bit more about the state, as we learned about in the first part of the show, and also how to raise a healthy, happy family. So thank you so much for watching. Don't go anywhere, because we're going to have more great JCTV programming coming your way. Thank you so much for joining us.